life from the beginning of this year. We are not taking it for granted. So we lift up our voice. We say thank you. Father, even in this service today, this miracle job banquet service, we pray for the release of miracles unending. That even via the communion today, we decree miracle healings, miracle deliverances. Via your word today, as your word is going forth, let there be diverse instant miracles. Just as that brother testified, he said, while the service was on, and he heard the prophetic word that every hanging blessing is dropping. While the service was on, the alert came. Father, let not one person in this service leave this service the way they came to this service. If you are living here with a miracle, shout a stronger yet amen. Now stretch your hands toward this altar right now. God has sent this commission to wipe away the tears of men. And I'm standing here today as a privileged priest, sent as a bona fide partaker with the undertaker, that in this miracle job banquet service, your hands will never be idle again. That by this service today, every form of crying and weeping concerning businesses, career, they are turned into celebration today. From today, by this service, the works of this your hands shall be more than sufficient to feed your family. From this service today, the works of your hands, there are many here who can receive it. You become the breadwinner of your community. There are quite a number who are living this service today. You will be the Joseph of your state. Receive it in the name of Jesus. Put those blessed hands together for Jesus right now. And please, you may be seated. Your hands will never be empty again. In the name of Jesus Christ. It's my privilege this morning to welcome us into God's presence on our special miracle job banquet service, and also serves as our special monthly communion service. The communion today, it shall be for the renewal of our covenant health insurance, our divine health insurance with God. No sickness, no disease, no oppression will escape the mystery of the communion table today. And for those who can receive it, as you partake of this communion today, even your family members who are sick in Nigeria, out of Nigeria, wherever they are, the same power is flowing to them in this service. In the name of Jesus Christ. Now, the theme of the month is exploit is my birthright in Christ. Can we say that together right now? You better say it. I mean it very well right now. As you have declared it, so shall it be for you. And also, we have been looking at the subject, understanding the master key to a world of exploits. Understanding the master key to a world of exploits. Part 2A, first service, 2B, second service, 2C, third service. Life is governed by keys. If you are keyless in life, you'll be stranded. If you lack the key to open the door of your car or your house, you'll be stranded, even though it is your car, even though it's your house. And keys are no respecter of age. Keys are no respecter of environment. So long as you have the key, whether you are 5 years old or 100 years old, the door must open to you. I pray for some people here today that the keys that will launch you into an unending world of exploits shall be delivered in this service. Amen. Now, what do we mean by exploits? Exploit connotes outstanding accomplishment. Out of this world order of results, breaking new grounds, breaking records, setting new records. What is exploit? We talk about great success with strange impact. So it means strange success, great success with strange impact. I'm not hearing somebody there at all. The loudest you can right now. One more time right now. And that's our birthright. That's our heritage. Because we are born of the Most High. And the children of the Most High cannot be the most low. By the law of creation, everything produces after its kind. So if you are born again, you are redeemed to reign on the heart. You are not just to survive. We are redeemed not to struggle on earth. We are redeemed not to live a subsistence living. I remember our basic agriculture when I was in Form 3. They taught us agriculture. See, there's what they call subsistence farming. How many can still remember the agriculture? Subsistence farming, that means you produce for your wife, for yourself, and your children. That's all. We are not born again, not just to provide for ourselves, our wife, and our children. No. That is below the plan of God. We are redeemed to be a global citizen as children of God, to impact our world. He said, in thy seed, God talking to Abraham, shall all the families of the earth be blessed. All the families of the earth. What you believe is what you become. If you believe you can only bless your nuclear family alone, God stops you at there. If you believe you can only bless only your extended family, God stops you at there with you. If you believe only your village, why not? Orelokwe, it will limit you there. If you believe only your local government, Okwe, local government, it stops there for you. If you believe only Delta State, it stops there for you. If you believe entire Nigeria, wherever you stop, it shall be to you according to what? Your faith. We are not redeemed to struggle. Not one of us will disappoint destiny. Amen. What is exploit? Exploit talks about advanced success, compound success, compound success, going beyond you to make others succeed. Going beyond you to make others succeed. Through you, many others will succeed. I'm not hearing a great amen. You know, a wise man said, he said, you are not a success until you have a successor. Until you have people who can say they derive their living. They are successful. Life is good. Life is comfortable through your life. Until you have people who can testify like that, no matter what you have, no matter your position, no matter your status, you are a failure. Because you are not fulfilling destiny. You are ordained to be a blessing to the world. And the more people you are a blessing to, then the more successful you are. Nobody here will disappoint that destiny. Amen. Now, also very important, exploit is impossible without God. Exploit is what? Psalm 127 verse 1, it said, except the Lord build a house, they labor in vain that build it. It said, except the Lord keep the city, the watchman wicked but in vain. No matter what you do in life, it will amount to nothing without God. In John chapter 15, verse 5, it says, for without me, you can do what? Nothing. Strong will cannot deliver exploits. Strong will. Romans chapter 9, verse 16, it says, not to him that will it. It's not to him that a strong will, strong determination cannot deliver success. Skills cannot deliver exploits. Your skill, your certificate, Your qualifications. Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 11. So the God factor is the principal factor to experience exploit in life. Outstanding accomplishment. Ovation commanding accomplishment. The God factor. Say me the God factor. I'm not hearing something right now. And Jesus came to show us the example. As the grand master of exploit, the grand commander of exploit. The grand commander of exploit. There were many things said about him in Mark chapter 2, verse 12. People exclaimed about him. He said, we have never seen it before in this fashion. We have never seen it in this fashion. That means they are record-breaking things. The things eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. The things that have not entered to the heart of man, they were the natural occurrence in the life of Christ. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 27, they exclaimed about him also. He said, what manner of man is this? What kind of human being is this one? That even the winds and the sea obey him. Outstanding, ovation commanding, exclamation provoking comments from people. By reason of your results. That's your portion from today. Amen. I said there shall be no question marks on your life from today. Amen. And it is the love of God that is the master key to that realm of exploit. Say me, the love of God. If you are there, shout it better right now. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 9. We said that last time. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. Neither has it entered the heart of man. The things that God has prepared for them that love him. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. He said, all things work together for good. To them that love God. Say me all things. I'm not hearing somebody there. All things, career things, business things, financial things, children things, marital things, enemies, friends. All things are working in your favor. That's the new you from now. Amen. I said that's the new you from now. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So every lover of God is a commander of exploits. He enjoys exploits on a natural frequency. And I would like to explain that very quickly before I continue. In our series of teachings in the midweek, we are looking at a subject that love is what connects humanity to divinity. That he that dwelleth in love, dwelleth in God, and God dwells in him. Hello? He that dwelleth in love, dwelleth where? In God. And what happens? God also does what? How? Colossians chapter 3, verse 14. The Bible talks about love as the rope that ties two people together. Above all these things, put on charity. Charity talks about love, which is the bond, which is the rope of perfection. Please, can you give me another version of the Bible there? Either Living Bible or so many versions. I have a version here, NRSV version. It said, love is what holds them together. Which one are you giving me there? No. Give me another version, please. He said, love is the rope that ties two people together in perfect union. Okay, that's good. He said, clothe yourself with love, which binds everything. Say, binds everything. You better say it very well right now. Binds everything together in what? In imperfect harmony? In perfect harmony. Love ties together. Now, what love does for us is, when you are in love with God, love ties you to God. You cannot be separated from God. When you love God, it's like a man in love with a woman, an husband and wife marries. And one plus one is equal to what? One. So, when you love God to that level, you become one with God. And whatever answers to God begins to answer to you. Because you are now one. If a man, a prominent man, goes for an important occasion, he goes with his wife, wherever the man goes, they'll place the wife either beside him or around him. Am I communicating at all? In the same manner, just like the president of Nigeria now, the wife of the president did not contest for election. But the fact that she's married to the president, in love with the president, whatever the president enjoys, what happens to her? She enjoys. So the same thing, when we are in love with God, whatever bows to God, the God kind of experiences, wisdom, power, favor, riches begin to answer to us. And I believe God that by these words, somebody is being baptized with the love of God afresh. Amen. If you are there, shout a stronger amen. Amen. That is why every true love of God dominates his environment, dominates his substance, his circumstances. Every love of God is never under any circumstance. It's always on top, because God will always be on top. From today, you shall be on top. Amen. That is why every true love of God is a potential pace setter, a pathfinder, and a trailblazer. Now, an example is a man called Solomon. Say me, Solomon. Solomon the lover became the greatest king on earth. Solomon the man who said, Lord, I don't know how to do anything. I don't know how to take steps. But when he began to demonstrate a love for God, God granted him so much wisdom that the Bible says, all the kings of the heart came to hear of the wisdom of Solomon. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3 to 14. Then you get to 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 29 to 34. Solomon loved the Lord, and he became a global celebrity, a global wonder. He loved the Lord to the point where he was wiser than all men. According to scripture, say he was wiser than all men. There are people who will rise in this church today who will be said to be wiser than the wisest of men. Yeah. Because he was now sharing the wisdom of God by love. Love connected him to the wisdom of God. Also, we are familiar with the story of David, the love of God. He became a national hero at the age of 17. The love for God drove him to confront Goliath. Another David will leave this service today. Now, the question is, what is love? We don't want to assume. What is love? I remember about two, 3 years ago in this church, about 2 years ago, 2 years plus, we had a youth meeting. And singles and all of that. And I asked the youth, I said, what is the meaning of love? And I heard all manner of definitions. One guy stood up and said, love is that thing that, like butterfly in your stomach when you love somebody. All manner of definitions. So we should not assume that we know what love is all about. Assumption is the mode of frustration. Quickly, we'll take two, three definitions before we move on this morning. Biblical love can be described as the God-first lifestyle. So you mean God-first lifestyle. Biblical love talks about God-first, God-priority lifestyle. God in the morning, God in the evening. Addiction to God is what we mean by love for God. When you are addicted to anything, even when you don't have money, those who are addicted to drugs, when they don't have money, they can go and steal to buy the drugs so that they can snuff it and sniff it and do whatever nonsense they want to do. When somebody is addicted to alcohol, he can sell anything to go and buy alcohol. God addiction. Say, make God addiction. There are some people after this coming today, you become God addicted. Number two, what is love for God? It is placing God above all else, including yourself. Placing God above everything and everyone, including yourself. Luke 14, 26. Jesus said, if any man comes to me and wants to make the most of his journey with me, this is the approach. If any man come to me and hate not his father, mother, and wife, and children, and brethren and sisters, and his own life, say me, his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. The word idea is a literal word. That means he must put me above himself, above his parents, above his own life, above his business, above his career. That's what God is saying. To make the most of our walk with God. It has to be that. People don't like that scripture. Some people now, if you take their Bible, they have used black ink to color it. You're painting that scripture in your Bible does not cancel it. Is somebody there? It's like somebody now adjusts his wristwatch and says, no, my own time is not 7:30 now. My own time is 3 p.m. Would that change the time? No. Placing God above everything, including yourself. Number three, definition of love. Love is identifying with Christ openly, publicly, and unashamedly. Identifying with Christ openly, publicly, and unashamedly. Mark chapter 8, verse 38. He said, whosoever is ashamed of me in this adulterous and wicked generation, me too, I'll be ashamed of him. It is identifying with God. Psalms 119, verse 48. He said, I'm not ashamed. Apostle Paul speaking also. He said, I will not be ashamed before kings. Okay, that's from the scripture. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. He said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. I am not ashamed of the gospel. The reason why many will never talk to others about all this operation go forward, they are ashamed of God. The God that you are ashamed of is not the God that can bless you. It's not the God that will heal you. If you are ashamed of him, it will be ashamed of you. The grace to identify with him publicly and privately, may you receive it today. Somebody said, how can an MD like me, managing director, CEO, DMD, you know DMD? Damaging and managing director. A whole CEO like me, how can I go on outreach? Many are too big for God. If you are too big to be instructed by God, then you'll be too small to be blessed by God. If you are too big to be instructed by God, anything making anyone to be too big to follow scriptural instruction, that thing wants to push a man into destruction. God is not our advisor, he's our commander. It's not. So we are not coming to church to just come and be entertained. We come to church to be instructed by God so that we can fulfill our destiny. He said, if you shall hearken diligently to the voice of the Lord thy God, then God will set you upon high. I don't know where anybody is today, but wherever you are today is by the grace of God. But may God not turn his back on anyone. Because when God turns his back, disgrace is inevitable. So no matter the level of anyone, don't put yourself above the word of God. If Bishop Oyedepo can be going on outreach, nobody has any excuse. Nobody is as busy as that man. Under this commission, we have over 16,000 people who are earning salary every month. Every month. How many people in your organization? You are saying MD. MD of what? Ask your neighbor, MD of what are you? Ask him. Don't you look at me. I say, ask your neighbor, MD of what are you? My friend. May you receive grace today. I said, may you receive grace today. In the name of Jesus Christ. Now, biblical proofs of love. Very quickly. Number one, if you love God, you will love his word. If you love God, you will love his word. Psalm 119, verse 162. I rejoice at thy word as one that findeth grace for it. If you love God, you will love his word. You like to read your Bible. You like to be hearing the word of God. Number two, if you love God, you will speak of God to others. You will do what? You will speak of God to others. Psalms 119, verse 46. Psalms 119, verse 46. I will speak of the testimonies also before kings, and I will not be ashamed. That was David the lover. David, the man who commanded exploits from age 17, he became a national hero. After David went, 3,000 years after he had gone, they were still marking the bad day of David. If you go to Israel today and go to the tomb of David, multitudes still line up every time to to see the tomb of David. In fact, they prayed there, the tomb of David. What do you call that? That is exploit. Extraordinary. Some of us, I have a great grandfather now. I don't know the village of my great grandfather. There's no traceable mark anywhere. But somebody passed here, 3,000 years, people are still visiting his tomb. Another David will leave this service today. Yeah. The hundreds of years after your departure, people will still be talking about you. Yeah. Those are the things we are talking about. We're not just talking about material things, things that transcend the now. Talk to others about God. I will not be ashamed. I will speak it in boardroom. I will speak it in the plane. I will speak it on the road. I will speak it in offices. I will speak it in the bank. I will not be ashamed of those who are around me. They are not the one making me. They are not my source. So no matter the size of the man, I can tell them, God bless you, sir. I would like to tell you about Christ, that Jesus loves you, and that he wants to make life better for you. I know life is good right now, but Jesus will make it better. And look at him with his Bentley car. And you are using Volkswagen. Just tell him, Jesus loves you. I will not be ashamed. Say me, I will not be ashamed. You better say it very well right now. In the name of Jesus Christ. Now, very quickly, securing miracle jobs in recession. Say me, securing miracle jobs in recession. Securing miracle jobs in recession. I said something in the course of the week, that recession is not a scriptural word. I mean, it's not something for the believer. It is for natural men. It's for who? Every child of God is not a natural man. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Please, we need to have this understanding. And we need to be saying this a lot in the church so that people will not become a victim of recession, victim of ignorance. To be a victim of recession is to be a victim of ignorance. To be a victim of recession is to be a victim of what? To be a victim of the financial economic holocaust in the world today is to be a victim of ignorance. Every child of God is a supernatural being. He said, the natural man receives not the things that are of God. So that means we have natural men and we have supernatural men. Say, I am a supernatural being. Now, every child of God, you have a miracle working God, a miracle working father. So if your father is a miracle worker, you are also a child of miracles. Say me, I'm a child of miracles. Very, very important. Very, very important. Very, very important. Because every child of God is an heavenly citizen. There's no recession, there's no famine in heaven. There's no downsizing in heaven. So if you limit your life to what is happening on planet Earth, then you become a victim of what is happening here. Isaiah chapter 5, verse 13. He said, my people are gone into captivity because they lack knowledge. They have become victims. They have become captives instead of captives because they have no knowledge of what has been provided for them. Praise God. Now, the will of God is for every of his children to be gainfully engaged. Isaiah chapter 3 verse 10 says, say ye to the righteous, it shall be well with him, for he shall eat of the fruit of his doings. That's God's will. And God hates idleness. Matthew chapter 20 verse 6. In that parable, he said he stole many and found others standing idle, and said unto them, why stand ye here idle all the day? All the day. That means it is not the will of God for a man and a woman to be jobless or to have a shop and not to sell, to open in the morning and close in the evening. I have no gain to show at the end of the day. It is illegal. And today, that illegality is ending in somebody's life. Yeah. To go to school, have certificate, sleepless nights, study, pass exams, and come out of NYSC. Years has gone by, no job. It is an error. It is evil. That evil is being reversed here today in somebody's life. It's not the will of God. Please, don't follow what the world is saying. Don't follow them to say, exchange rate, price of crude, that is for the world. In heaven, nothing goes down in heaven. If everything finishes on heart, God will be supplying from heaven. Those who believe are shouting a stronger amen now. The Christian faith is not limited by natural things. He said, we walk by faith and not by sight. We are not ruled by what we see. We are not ruled by what we hear. We are ruled by the word of God. The word of God is what rules and dominates circumstances of the heart. Abraham lived in time of recession. He never felt it. Isaac lived in time of recession. He never felt it. Jacob lived in recession. They never felt it. In fact, they said Jacob was giving his children double money to go and buy food in Egypt. You hear the testimony of somebody right now? When others were being downsized, he got two big international jobs. And the one he now picked had 250 percentage increase. Who told you there are no jobs? Who told you? Newspaper. Minister of Finance. Or IMF, or World Bank. Are they God? God ruleth by his power forever. He rules everything on planet Earth by the word of his power. Say me, the word of his power. I'm not hearing somebody right now. So by this word you are hearing today, you'll be ruling your world. I said you will be ruling your world. There's a song we normally sing. Me, I know we'll suffer. I no go back for bread. God of miracle. God of miracle. You see, people sing religious songs without understanding the content of the song. So if you understand that song, that is the kind of song you'll be singing now. That all this suffering in the world, it is minus me. I have a miracle working God. I cannot be living with obstacles. I cannot be a victim of all the financial obstacles. I said something in the week also. If you take a man, a woman in Bible, Bible said the woman was bent down for 18 years. She couldn't raise her head. If they take that woman to hospital, to Ogara, doctors will use an X-ray and say this woman has dislocated vertebral column. Am I not correct? When he came to Jesus, Jesus said, no, it's not dislocated vertebral column. Nothing was dislocated. He said, the spirit of infirmity. The what? You see, God's diagnosis and prescription are totally different from man's diagnosis and prescription. So, you have a choice as to how you see things. You can see it from the natural perspective or see it from God's perspective. That is why you can be a child of God and be suffering what unbelievers are suffering. Say, I lay before you life and death. I advise you, choose life. That in the midst of recession, I say you shall be blossoming. Amen. Well, those who are receiving it are shouting the stronger, amen. Amen. That's God's word. That's God's word. God does not condone business frustration. You are familiar with the story of Peter. Peter said, we have toiled all the night and caught nothing. Jesus said, well, I want to help you. But if I want to help you, this is what you do. Give me your boat. Drop your net here. And he had a net breaking boat sinking catch. So there's always what you must do if you must escape natural frustrations in your business and in your career. Very quickly, I'll drop two kids with us and we'll take the communion that we're out of here. Somebody here, you'll be smiling when others are complaining. If you're among them, shout a stronger amen. Amen. Psalm 37 verse 19 must be your scripture for this season. Psalm 37 verse 19. He said, they shall not be ashamed in evil time. Evil times are upon the world today. Evil times economically. He said, my people shall not be ashamed in evil times. And in the days of famine, of recession, they shall be what? What's the meaning of satisfied? That means they will have anything they want. The one they want for themselves, the one they want for their family members, the one they want for others, all of it shall be what? They shall be what? I release divine satisfaction upon somebody here today. So stop seeing what they are seeing. What are the keys? Very quickly, number one, be planted in Zion. Be what? Don't be a visitor in Zion. This is the time to be playing religion. Be planted in Zion. Now, those scriptures we read in the call to worship, Psalm 87. If you get to the last verse, verse 7, he said, all my springs, they shall be in Zion. If you check Living Bible translation of that Psalms, he said, everything that makes for life and godliness, all the people that matter, all the good things of life will be domiciled in Zion. Domiciled in Zion. When others are grumbling, complaining, going down, he said, every good thing will be blossoming in Zion. And you'll be a partaker of it. Yeah. I said, you'll be a partaker of it. Yeah. So, he said, they that be planted in the courts of our God, they shall flourish. It doesn't matter what is happening outside. They will be flourishing. From today, you shall be flourishing. Yeah. I said, from today, you shall be flourishing. Yeah. If you look at Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1 to verse 22, very powerful scripture. He said, arise, shine, for your light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. He said, for behold, the darkness shall cover the heart. So, the darkness of economic recession is global. He said, and gross darkness, the people. But your name is not the people. But the Lord, say me, but the Lord. Say it one more time right now. That means you will not, but means you are exempted from what they are suffering. But the Lord shall arise upon thee. When others are suffering shame, he said, the glory of God shall be seen over your life. Yeah. I said, the glory of God shall be seen over your business. Yeah. The glory of God shall be seen over your career. Yeah. The glory of God shall be seen over the works of your hands. Yeah. Powerful. Verse 3. Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. That means when others are in darkness, you shall be rising. Yeah. When others are going down, I said, you shall be rising. I'm not playing words here. These are prophetic injections. If you take this injection, you are rising. I said, when others are going down, you are rising up. The greatest business people of this time, they are coming from this church. Well, those ones are shouting a stronger amen. Now, if you go down the line, in verse 8 now? He said, who, verse 8, he said, who are these that fly as a cloud? That means high flyers will be emerging when others are suffering blackness. High flyers, say me, high flyers. Verse 10, and the sons of strangers shall build up your walls. That means when others don't know what to do, when others are jobless, there are people in this church who will be employing foreigners. Oh, you didn't understand what I said. I said there are members of this church that by reason of God's hand upon their businesses, they'll be employing Americans. Amen. They'll be employing Britons. Amen. They'll be employing Chinese. Amen. They'll be employing Japanese. Amen. In addition to Nigerians. Amen. I know people in this church who are employing foreigners. They're employing what? They are not looking for dollars. They are paying dollars. They are connected to heaven. They are connected to where their supplies are inexhaustible. Some people here are being connected to that source today. Amen. If you are there, shout a stronger amen. Amen. Now, just because of time, if you go down the line, the last verse of that scripture, because all these things happen in Zion. He said, a little one shall become a thousand. Verse 22. And a small one, a what? A strong nation. Men like nations. They will be rising from this church. Amen. Remember from where we started from. It said darkness shall cover the heart and gross darkness the people. In the midst of that darkness, some people are rising like nations. Amen. Oh, I thought that we are stronger yet. Amen. Amen. And the clearer you see this word in Zion, the better. He said, I will hasten my word to perform. He said, thou as well seen, I will hasten my word to perform. If you can see these prophetic scriptures, God will perform them in your life. Amen. So what is be happening to you from now? Say me, I'm going forward. I am going higher. When others are being sacked, when others are being sacked, I am being promoted. When others are jobless, I will have multiples of jobs to choose from. Please, that must be your language. Those are the things you need to be. Saturate your ears with it. When you're sleeping, when you are dreaming, those are the things you must be dreaming so that you can become it. As many as receive the word and believe the word, they will become it. So, saturate yourself with these thoughts. Saturate yourself with it, and you shall be blessed. Number two, very quickly, partner with God in Zion. Don't just be planted in God. Partner with God in Zion. God has ordained the endless growth of his church. Zion means the church. I will build my church. Matthew 6:18. Perfect, present, continuous tense. Not that I built. I will continue to build my church. He said, of the increase of his government, there shall be what? There shall be no end. Isaiah chapter 7 verse 8 or so. Let me check that scripture. So, it's not enough to be planted in Zion. Be a laborer in Zion. Be engaged in your father's business. Jesus came, he said, I must be about my father's business. I must be about my father's business. When you are about your father's business, God will be about your business. And when God is about your business, then miracle jobs become your portion. Is somebody still there? God cannot be for you. And one employer will tell you, you are not employed. God cannot be for you, and any barrier of life will stop you. When you are working for God, God begins to work with you. And when God is with you, he said the mountains will skip like rams. Obstacles will sense your approach and they will vanish. That is a mystery of partnering with God. Make it your lifestyle. That is the purpose of all this wonder double. There's no greater scripture than Matthew 6:33. Doing one thing and getting every other thing added to you. When you work for God, God begins to work for you. And when God works for you, that is a miracle. When God begins to work for you, he begins to break protocols for your sake. He begins to favor you. What we call miracles are natural laws suspended to favor somebody. What are miracles? Natural laws, governmental laws, medical laws suspended for a while for somebody to be favored. After the person has been favored, status quo, go, take a while. So when you favor his kingdom, God said, don't worry. I will give you jobs you never applied for. And we'll be hearing testimonies. We shared a testimony on Friday, one of us here. He had been working somewhere and he started engaging in wonder double. They sack others minus him. Now, they now reduce his job responsibility and now double the salary. Hello, I like that one. They reduce his responsibility and did what? After that, they now employ two of his sons. Ah. Two of what? Two of his children were employed. For your sake, nobody shall be jobless in your family. You see, these are not natural things. Many of us hear the testimony of one sister here who was doing wonder double and came to cook food for them in Bible school. He said she went to Adam, I don't know whether it's Tivo or something like that. And she was there. Somebody saw and said, excuse me, I just like you. What's your name? What do you do? Okay, can you come here on Monday? She never knew the person from anywhere. And they gave her a miracle job on Monday without application.
When you begin to work for you, God begins to work for you. And when God works for you, he begins to break protocols for your sake. So what do we need? The grace to labor for him. Be in the employment of Jesus. And let me see which employer or which client can reject your proposal. Is somebody still there? In Luke chapter 10 verse 1. Luke 10 verse 1. He said he appointed 70 others also. Be in the employment of Jesus. And when you are in his employment, he will pay you your hire. Verse 7 also. Luke 10 verse 7. He said the laborer is worthy of his hire. And God's hire includes favor. Say me favor. When you favor him, he favors you. And when God favors you, it is the favor of God that made Joseph a slave, a person under the charge of rape, attempted rape, a foreigner, to now become a prime minister. When God favored him, all the criminal charges against him were dropped. They forgot that he was not a citizen. Hello? They forgot that he was not a citizen. They forgot that he was a slave. Everything was against him. But when favor came, everything, obstacles, favor removed it. Favor removed it. As we partake of the communion today, everything working against your business and career prosperity, the favor of God will remove it today. So what do we need? In this operation, go forward. Let Jesus employ you. Work for him. Pray for souls. We have publications, prayer points. Invest in it. It is the greatest business of the season. It will bring about the insurance of your career and business. Doing this one thing will bring about the explosion of your career and business. Now, particularly those of us who are not fully engaged right now, let it be your only job for the next 6 weeks. Let it be your only job in the morning, in the evening. Souls, pray for them, minister to them, bring them to church. And watch if you will not shed tears of joy before Shiloh 2016. Those ones who will share it are shouting the stronger, amen. I'm out of time. But one thing I know is that as we partake of this communion, whatever is blocking your favor from reaching you, they shall be destroyed. Amen. Whatever is contesting the place of God in every life, they shall be destroyed. Amen. By this communion today, the love of God shall be transmitted into every life afresh. Amen. The grace to be about our Father's business of hunting for souls shall be imparted to every partaker afresh. Amen. And as I partake of this communion today, in John chapter 6, verse 56 and 57, he said, if you eat my flesh, you shall begin to live by me. Whatever is unlike God, via this communion, in form of sickness and diseases, they shall be destroyed in somebody's life. Amen. If you are there, shout a stronger amen. Amen. Put your hands together for Jesus right now. Hallelujah. Now, very quickly, because this communion is already loaded, this communion table is already loaded, virtues is waiting already. But you are here, you are not born again. You may be a victim of the darkness befalling the world. You may be a victim of sicknesses and oppression. But your only escape to becoming a supernatural person is to accept Christ. Wherever you are, I know quite a number of people are here right now. You know you are not born again. You know you are a natural man. You are not yet a supernatural being. You are the one I'm talking to. I'd like you to stand to your feet. You need to accept Jesus today as your Lord and Savior. And you begin to decorate your life in every respect. God bless you. Stand to your feet right now. You want to give your life to Christ? You want a new life? You want your sins forgiven? You want God to decorate you in this time of season? God bless you. Stand to your feet. They are standing up already. God bless you. They are standing up. God bless you. Let them see what they are pursuing right now. While those who are giving your life to Christ are coming. You are giving your life to Christ. God bless you. At the back, wherever you are, carry your bags and Bible and begin to come this way. God bless you. I thought the church is clapping for them right now. Number two, in case you are born again and you have disconnected from God, you can reconnect yourself back to God by rededicating your life. I'd like also to stand to your feet, carry your bags, and come and join this first group. They are coming.